talk about the exuberance that you still see around the space and ultimately whether we're wringing our hands about the opportunity but also the risks enough.
Well, we shouldn't wring our hands about the opportunities. The opportunities are there. There's a hype wave at the moment. And I remember the web.com crash. I'm just saying that, putting it out there. When everyone piled into web companies and the technology wasn't mature enough and we had a crash. The generative AI, people may be buying into it, but it's not proven yet as a thing that business can use. I'm not saying it won't be, but at the moment, is it reliable enough? And there's a lot of competition. We don't really know what the business models are. They're still to be explored. And so I personally wouldn't be buying shares in AI companies at the moment, but then I'm not a stocks and shares person, so I'm not an economist either.
Wendy, we appreciate the perspective. We'll go to commercialization in a second. Today is Meta Connect, and we will hear from the parent company of Facebook what they are doing in the world of artificial intelligence. But broadly, they have stuck to the doctrine of open source development. What is your position on open source development?
Well, I'm a typical academic. I love it for the innovation it provides, but I worry about the risks and who's responsible. It's the world of responsible AI. If who's responsible for the use of that open source, and who's responsible for whether it goes to the bad actors or the good actors. And down the line, as we talk about regulation, we have to talk about regulation of open source as well as the regulation of the core generators of the technology.
I seem to recall when Meta first announced Llama 2 and Nick Clegg was out there discussing about why they're focused on open sourcing. You said, and I think it was you, saying, look, this is potentially like giving people the instructions for a nuclear bomb here. Do you still stand by that it could be as impactful? And do you think Meta and the rest of the regulatory community are reacting to that?
Well, I stand by what I said in the sense that it makes people think about what we're doing, right? If the AI companies are saying, we can't explain how this stuff works, but we're putting it out there anyway. I'm not a doomsayer about this. I think generative AI is going to be a profoundly positive technology if used well and responsibly. But lots of people are pulling, Jeffrey Hinton and people have pulled out of it. They're all saying it's dangerous, we've got to be careful. But then they're giving away the open source versions. It just seems so contradictory in my mind. If you think something is so dangerous, shouldn't you be making sure, very sure, about who the people you're giving it to and what they're going to do with it?
But also, what's interesting is an NVIDIA executive has since left the business, haven't been there since 2001, claiming that their biggest concern is the fact that it is being dominated by big tech players and that there isn't enough of the startups being able to come in and other players being able to be at the table. Do you agree with that narrative? I mean, we're about to have yet another summit occurring where you are in the UK.
Well, I won't be at the summit, right? The people at the summit, it's at Bletchley Park, which is tiny. There's about 120 seats you can get into the conference room. And the number of countries, divide that by the number of countries attending, there won't be many reps from every country. We may need diplomats, people from the intelligence agencies, because it's all about cybersecurity, national security, and it'll be the tech bros, the people running the tech companies that'll be there. There won't be diversity of thought, of any type there. So I really worry that this whole conversation is being run by the tech companies, and they're being effectively asked to regulate themselves and they're giving away stuff to, here's the open source guys, you do this. Who's responsible in this food chain? Where is the responsibility? That's what worries me.
Well, Wendy, let's talk about the nation. Well, that's why I want to ask you, though, Wendy, about the nation state level action, right? We had Joe White on the show last week, the UK technology ambassador, and he was telling Caroline and I about all the meetings he's having with the tech companies to secure the compute, the chip makers, the hyperscale cloud providers. So I understand your concerns, but do you at least see the UK trying to get itself at a national level in a position of leadership in what is a nascent technology?
Yes, of course I do. And a lot of the things they're doing is I totally applaud. We have to put more money into this. The UK does. I mean, we don't. We are never going to be able to put the amount of money the US and China puts in. The EU's bigger than us. It could put more in. We don't have the companies in Europe, of course. They're all in Washington or in Shenzhen in China. And so we can only lead by regulating, governing. And I've always said that that's the right thing for us to do because we're good at that sort of stuff. But just at the moment, since ChatGPT came out, everything has flipped in the UK. It's really turned so that it is all about the technology at the moment and the safety risks. And it's not about, very little about what how you, you know, the good things that this can be used for and how it's going to be used by society.
Yes.
And involving the wider community in those debates.
Dame Wendy Hall, on that note then, let me ask you then, in your research, what are you most excited about artificial intelligence bringing to society?
Well, I'm excited about the things that that AI can do that will give us answers to questions we couldn't possibly work out without it. So, example, in health, everyone talks about health, but the breakthroughs are already coming. It will relieve people of the drudgeries of some of the boring jobs, create new jobs. It will help us with solving the big grand challenges of the world, like the climate change and energy and food security. And, you know, we'll be able to do things with AI and data we couldn't possibly have done without it. And that's, you know, it's just, and it's going to change, generative AI is going to change how we do everything. It will change how you work, how I work, how students work. You know, it will be as profound as the introduction of the calculator and the computer back in the 70s, right? We will all approach the creation of things differently. But it doesn't mean that generative AI is going to wipe us out of existence as it is now. So that there's such a hype around the existential threat and we've got to, of course, talk about that and global, but it's not the immediate threats. So, you know, more about misinformation and threats to the democratic process, how AI might be used in the campaigns next year. And those are the things that worry me.